Good morning, grace and peace. Welcome to Find the Intersection. My name is Paul Dizay. Today is Tuesday, which means we talk about the New Testament passage. And during this season of ordinary time, we are looking at the book of Colossians on Tuesday. And today we're talking about Colossians 3, verses 1 to 11. And there's a few things I'd like to kind of bring out of the passage that God spoke to me today. The first thing is, when you're reading Colossians, it'd be very easy to read the word you and read it as God is talking specifically just to you. But that you is plural. But you have to remember that Paul is writing to a church, to a group of people. And so he's talking about the collective identity of a group of people. He uses the metaphor of baptism throughout this passage. It says in verse 1, so if you have been raised with Christ, so if you've been raised coming out of the water with Christ, you're a part of the identity of the church. You are a part of something new. You have a new identity, a new family. You are a part of and participate in a new group of people. It is a group of people in verse 11. It says where there is no longer Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, slaves or free. It's a new humanity, a new group of people. And so Paul is referring to this group, and in the context here, it's so important that we get this idea of a group and not just an individual. And so what is he telling this group? The second thing that stood out to me is he's saying, set your minds on things that are above. Put your focus on the kingdom of God, things of the kingdom of God. Put your time, your talents, your treasures, your energy into that which God reigns over. Don't put your time and energy and treasures into things of earth that are temporary. Put your energy into the kingdom of God, which is God reigning over God's people and the world. He uses this idea of being hidden. Says, for your life is hidden in Christ. Your life is hidden in the body of Christ. You are a part of something different. You are not a part of the way the rest of the world works, which is really what he's been talking about all the way through this book. Last week we talked about how this church was distracted by making Jesus plus something else. And so he's kind of keeping that in the background here by saying, keep your mind focused things on the kingdom of God. The third thing that really jumped out to me is a lot of the don't do this type of things. Again, he's writing to the church, and he's telling them practices that shouldn't be a part of their body, that shouldn't be part of their collective. And he's saying, put to death, therefore, whatever in you, so in the body of Christ, in the church, is earthly: fornication, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed. Now, greed connects back to what we talked about yesterday in the gospel passage and the parable that Jesus spoke of the rich fool. He says that greed is idolatry, and I really think he's talking about all of it. And then he goes down to verse number 8. He says, but you must get rid of such things, which is anger, wrath, malice, slander, and abusive language from your mouth. Again, the body of Christ, collectively, these are the things that shouldn't be a part of your collective identity as a group of people. Of course, we personalize that. And we should personally not do these things. But again, Paul's talking about the church, the body of Christ, the group that we are associated with and our salvation is being worked out into. Again, one of the biggest challenges in the church today is the individualization of Christians, where we think that we have a personal, private salvation that could exist independently of the local church. And Paul would have said, no, you're a part of something. You have to participate in this entity, this body. And that's where salvation, what you're being saved from, is an individualistic, selfish focus. You're being saved to be a part of something, a body that changes the world. So it's so important that we see what Paul is after here in this amazing passage. There's so much here. We could go on and on and on and on and on. But that is why I want to hear from you. So if you would share in the comments what God spoke to you in this passage. There's so much allusion of so many different things. And Colossians is an amazing letter. I did a sermon series about, 10 years ago, on this book a few churches back, and it was deep, powerful. Maybe I'd like to get into it again one day. But anyway, share your thoughts in the comments. We'll be back tomorrow as we continue our Old Testament dialogue in the book of Hosea. Grace and peace, everybody. See you later.